to understand what is normal, what is benign, what is pre-malignant, and what is considered as a frank malignancy. Okay, we need to understand all these histopathologically. And the only way to treat the patient in the right way is when you can diagnose the given biopsy correctly. Okay, so we should know the normal features, which you've studied in histology. I'm not going to repeat it. And then here in oral pathology, you're going to study the benign tumors, the pre-malignant pre-malignant lesions and conditions, and then frank neoplasms. Okay, so today we are going to start with the benign epithelial neoplasms, that is the epithelial neoplasms which are of benign in nature, they're not malignant. And in the next lecture after this, we'll be studying about the malignant epithelial neoplasms. So we will know how the benign epithelial neoplasms look and how the malignant ones look. So we'll start by defining what's a tumor, what's a neoplasm, and then we'll list out some common features of the benign tumors. All benign tumors have some similar features, so we will see what they are so that you remember it very well. And we will discuss squamous papilloma, keratoacanthoma, and nevus. There are many benign epithelial neoplasms. I'll show you a list of them, but we are going to discuss these three because they're kind of more common compared to others when it comes to the clinical appearance. They could come to your clinic with that. So tumor is a new growth representing the tissue of the origin. That is why we are talking about, whenever we say odontogenic tumor, epithelial tumor, meaning odontogenic is arising from the tooth. Okay, so it's representing the tissue of origin. So that tumor represents that particular origin. Epithelial tumors are from epithelium. Okay, so you can define it as an abnormal mass of tissue. It's a mass of tissue, and its growth is exceeded and is uncoordinated with the normal tissue. The meaning of it is there is normal growth also, right? There's normal cell division also, which is taking normal proliferation, which is happening. But this exceeds the normal tissue, and it persists in this manner even after you remove the stimuli which has caused this kind of proliferation. For example, sometimes there is hyperplasia and hypertrophy of the tissue as well as a reaction to something, okay? But when you remove that stimuli, it stops. So the hypertrophy goes back, it regresses, the hyperplasia regresses, and it goes back to normal. But tumor is not like that. The division continues, the hyperplasia continues even after you remove that stimuli. So that's the definition. And neoplasm is nothing but the tumor itself. Again, it continues to grow indefinitely. Okay, so that can be called as a neoplasm. So you have benign and the malignant. Today we are going to discuss the benign tumor, and there are certain characteristics of the benign tumor which you should know of. Insidious means it is like a sudden onset, okay, like without any reason. There is nothing which has triggered it. It just started, okay? So that's the meaning of the insidious onset, and the rate of the growth is slow and it goes over a very long period of time. So when something is very long and it is very slow, what is that condition called? The pathology, the term we use for those conditions, as opposed to something very fast and sudden. When it is slow and for a long duration, it's chronic. Acute is fast and it is progresses in a very rapid manner. Well-defined mass, it will have a fibrous capsule. So how does it translate clinically? I have explained this plenty times during the last few lectures. So how can this mean for you as a clinician when it comes to treating the benign tumor? It has a well-defined capsule. It has a good border which with the surrounding normal tissue. What does it mean? So whenever there is a well-defined mass with a fibrous capsule, very clear discernation of the tumor and the surrounding tissue, it's easy for the surgeon to remove it. Okay, the removal in toto or in total will become very easy. So it's asymptomatic. Most of the benign tumors, you don't know they're present because you don't have pain, you don't have it doesn't grow very big, so you don't know it is present. So most of the symptoms which are caused due to the benign tumors are because of the pressure effect on the surrounding structures, or sometimes it can cause swelling, it can grow big. So only in these two scenarios you will have some symptoms because of the benign tumor. And they're much, much smaller normally. They don't grow to very huge size, except in some cases compared to the malignant tumors. And there is usually displacement of the adjacent normal tissue, especially when they're growing big. And if it is applying any kind of pressure, then it can cause displacement of the adjacent normal tissue. And it is painless and they never metastasize. So that's the spread of the tumor. So spread of the tumor can be like from epithelium to connective tissue. That's when it is called as a malignant, or it when it's malignant, it can metastasize to distant organs. That is, it can go to liver, heart, kidney, and it can cause death. So whenever there is malignancy, the death is not because of the primary tumor. Suppose you have a squamous cell carcinoma in the mouth. You don't die because of the tumor which is in the mouth, but they can spread to the lung and liver and other organs, and those organs, their vital organs, that's what is keeping you alive. When they fail is when you die. Okay, so that is not there in benign tumor. It do not, it does not metastasize. Okay, so the epithelial tissue neoplasms, which are of benign in nature, are squamous papilloma, keratoacanthoma, squamous acanthoma, and nevus. We are going to only study the papilloma, keratoacanthoma, and nevus today, because these two are very similar. I don't want to confuse you, and this is quite rare. So I'm going to discuss these three, which I think are important and you should know. So the squamous papilloma, okay? Whenever we use the term papilloma, it has finger-like projections, okay? Papillary projections are nothing but finger-like projections, and they're also called as exophytic growth. Exo means outwards, okay? Whenever something grows outwards, it is called as exophytic. So endophytic is like burrowing kind of a growth. It doesn't grow outward, but it causes burrowing in the tissue, okay? So this is an exophytic benign lesion, and it is supposed to resemble cauliflower. That's your like broccoli, the white cruciform vegetable. Okay, so it's supposed to resemble your cruciferous vegetable like cauliflower, and the size can go up to a centimeter or so in diameter. As you can see, this is tongue. And here you have on the lateral border the squamous papilloma. It's even lesser than 1 centimeter here, actually. And these are the papillary projections, which are supposed to resemble your cruciferous vegetable. And there is a causative organism behind this, which is thought to be responsible for the squamous papilloma. That's your human papilloma virus, or HPV. So some strains of human papilloma virus can cause oropharyngeal carcinoma, okay? Which is the junction between your oral cavity and the pharynx. And that's why this virus was quite famous. And then they found a vaccination against the virus because it was quite rampant, the oropharyngeal carcinoma. Anyhow, so the HPV is normally there in your oral cavity like many other organisms. If you don't know already, one drop of saliva will have 10 to the power of 6 microorganisms. Okay, so that's the number of microorganisms which is there in your saliva. So this is also one such microorganisms which is present. and that's what causes the oral papilloma. These are not malignant and they're neither pre-malignant, okay? Although some strains will cause carcinoma, but papilloma is totally benign. And if you just want to know the strains of HPV which causes oropharyngeal carcinoma, it's the strain 16 and 18, which are more scary actually. Whereas papilloma is caused by 6. You don't have to remember it, just for your interest, I'm telling. They're usually solitary, but sometimes they can be present more than one in number. But if they're a lot in number and if they become confluent, okay, that is if they're attached to each other, if they start getting merging with each other, then you have to doubt that there is something more dangerous going on, like a immunodeficiency syndrome. That's your HIV, okay? Human immunodeficiency virus infection. You have to doubt. And you, as a dentist, you have to become extra careful if you're treating the patient, because you know, it spreads by blood, and there are some studies which say that it could even spread by saliva. It's not really proven, but there are hypotheses, okay? Another fact which you might want to know is the squamous papilloma, which happens in the oral cavity, is alternative to the wart, the skin wart. The warts which occur on the skin, it's quite a common condition among people. So the skin wart oral counterpart is your squamous papilloma. Even the skin wart is caused by the papilloma virus, okay? So any age group can be affected by squamous papilloma, including the children. So there is no specific age group which is more commonly affected. Any age group can be affected. The most common sites, even in the image which I showed you, it was the tongue, followed by lips and soft palate. It is quite well circumscribed, you saw. It is soft and it is painless in nature. Sessile or pedunculated? What do you mean by sessile and pedunculated? So sessile means it's like fixed, and it is like directly attached to the the underlying mucosa. Whereas pedunculated means it will have a stalk, like how you saw in the papilloma, okay? So it will be movable. So that's the difference between sessile and pedunculated. Okay, so like I said, it's an exophytic growth with a lot of finger-like projections or surface projections, and that's what gives it a wart-like appearance or a cauliflower-like appearance. And the white color, it could be white or pink. In the lesion which I showed you, it was almost white, but there are also some papillomas which are like pinkish in color. This depends upon the amount of keratinization. So more keratinization, it will look white in color. If the keratinization is not that extensive, then it will appear pink in color. So that's the difference in the color. So whatever we discussed in the clinical, that it has finger-like projection, it is pedunculated, all the same things you will describe histopathologically also. So this is the stalk through which the lesion is attached to the underlying tissue, whether it's tongue or lip or whatsoever. These are the finger-like projections. You can see, I think here you see more closer resemblance to the cauliflower, right? And these are the finger-like projections of the epithelium. And inside, if you see, there is a core of connective tissue supporting or supplying the nutrition to these finger-like projections, because connective tissue is here and we need this benign tumor to receive some nutrition. So there is a core of connective tissue which is supporting these finger-like projections. And like I said, it's the keratinization and the amount of keratin which imparts a white color. So if you see on the surface of all these finger-like projections, especially here, you will see a very thick keratin on the surface. Okay? These finger-like projections are also called as fronds. Okay? Other terminology to use is fronds. Even if you say finger-like, it's perfectly fine. So that's the histopathology of papilloma. So when you correlate the clinical feature with the histopathology, the diagnosis is very easy. This is another image again. So you have more fronts or finger-like projections here, and you can see the connective tissue core in each of these finger-like projection, and this is your stalk. And underneath that stalk, you will have the connective tissue with blood vessels and everything, okay? How do you manage it? I told you it has a pedicle or a stalk, right? So you have to do an elliptical incision and you have to cut the base of that mucosa. Otherwise it can regrow again, okay? So you have to make sure that you're removing the base along with the pedicle or the stalk. That's what is the treatment if you're using surgical treatment. There are also some chemical treatments. See, I don't know if any of you have had warts in your life or anyone in your family has had. So some chemicals can be used to treat the skin warts as well. So similarly, even oral warts or papillomas can be treated by application of either formaldehyde or silver nitrate. It has to be prescribed by the dentist and whatever percentage it has to be followed. And suppose the tumor is properly excised, then the recurrence is rare. It will never come back. So that was the squamous papilloma. So the next benign epithelial neoplasm is called as keratoacanthoma. See, all these words will have some description of the lesion within it, okay? So this kerato basically is indicating for the keratin which is seen in the lesion. So acanthoma is anything which is related to squamous. It is called as acanthoma. So it's a benign endophytic growth. So this is opposite to exophytic. That means it is more burrowing kind of a lesion. Okay, it's again well circumscribed. It has a crater, meaning like a ditch, which is filled with the keratin, and it is usually seen on a sun-exposed skin, on people who are that expose themselves to sun. So this is often mistaken for squamous cell carcinoma because of the appearance, and then the etiology is also there, that is the sunlight, the UV light. So it can be often confused, but of course histopathologically it shows very benign features. We'll see what they are. So clinically, it is seen on the hair-bearing skin, meaning wherever there is hair, like your back and on the leg, and these areas is where you see, and usually people lie on their back when they're exposing themselves to the sun more than the other areas. So when it comes to the oral cavity and the head and neck area, it is your lip which is affected, because lip, as you know, there is a part of the skin and then there is part of your oral mucosa beginning, correct? What is that border called between the skin and the mucosa for the lip? Vermilion border. So that's where you will see the lesion, okay? Wherever there is a hair-bearing region, that's where you will see. Males are more commonly affected, and you will see a butt-shaped nodule, as you can see here, okay? It's like a nodule, and you will see that it is filled with keratin, okay? And this usually regresses without any treatment. That's one good thing about the keratoacanthoma. You don't have to really do any treatment. It regresses on its own. But sometimes when it doesn't, then of course, and when you're doubting squamous cell carcinoma, you take a biopsy and you look at it. So histopathologically, it is very, very, it has a distinctive feature. So please look at this image. The most characteristic feature is found at the margin of the normal tissue, and this is the lesion. This is the normal tissue, okay? How we can make out this is the lesion is because there is acanthosis, that is increase in the thickness of the spinous layer, okay? So that's the acanthosis. And if you notice the redder ridges, they're all bulbous and broad in shape. And here is the crater in which lot of keratin which was filled clinically. So this is the crater which you can see histopathologically as well. So the border, how is it very distinct, is that till here you see epithelium is normal in thickness, and then there is kind of a sudden curve, and the edge of this is almost pointing to the center of the crater. and you see a sudden increase in the thickness of the epithelium because of the acanthosis. So that is the abrupt margin, which is the most distinctive feature of keratoacanthoma, followed by the crater filled with the keratin, of course. Again, central keratin plugging, which you see, and this is the border between the normal and the abnormal. Okay, and this is your broad rete ridges. And it might show pseudocarcinomatous growth as well. That's where you should distinct between squamous cell carcinoma and the keratoacanthoma. But it will not show any mitosis or nuclear pleomorphism like your cancer, and you can distinguish easily. So the treatment, I already told you, it is self-healing, and that's another reason it's also called as a self-healing tumor, the keratoacanthoma. But if at all you have to do any treatment, then you have to do the surgical excision, which is not only curative, even aesthetically it is quite acceptable because the tissue kind of regrows. It's quite small, so it doesn't show a lot like a ditch or something. But the patient will have to be followed up. The patient has to be asked, you have to ask the patient to come back after a few months, because there are many cases which are reported where the patient has developed primary squamous cell carcinoma. So for that reason, you have to ask the patient to come back. And that's another reason why you might want to do an excision and send for biopsy. Okay. So the last benign tumor, which we're going to discuss, is called as nevus. It's present usually on the face and of course on the rest of the body as well. But whenever it's present on the face, the mole is present on the face, it's called as a beauty spot. But it's nothing to do with the beauty or anything. It's just increasing the melanocytes in that area, that's all. So it's usually contrasting to your skin color, because it will be darker and black. In color, melanocytes produce like melanin is black, so that's why it might look you know, the contrast might make it look beautiful, so it's called as a beauty spot. So similar moles you can see within the oral cavity also, and they're called as the oral nevus. Okay, it's the same term, nevus, even on the skin, but when it's intraorally seen, you just call it as oral nevus. So it is defined as a congenital developmental tumor-like malformation of either skin or mucous membrane. So whenever you see in the skin, it is called as the dermal nevus. And when it is seen in the mucous membrane or the oral cavity, it is called as the oral nevus. That's the difference. So it is quite a superficial lesion. You can see it on the surface, and it is composed of nevus cells, like I said. And the other names which are used for this is pigmented mole or benign melanocytic nevus. These are the other terminologies used for this. So here you can see, this is a child which is showing nevus on the gingiva. You can see very clearly the contrast between the coral pink color and this discoloration. So that's one of the examples of the oral nevi. So if there are several types, so if it is seen in the birth itself, it is called as congenital nevus. Okay, anything which is seen at birth is called as congenital, and acquired is something which comes later in life. So there are several types of the nevus based upon where the nevus cells are distributed. So there are three different types. I'll start with the junctional. So junctional is seen, as the name says, junction between the epithelium and connective tissue. This is the epithelium, because you see the red ridges. This is the connective tissue. So when it is seen at the junction of the epithelium and connective tissue, it's called junctional nevus. Okay. Compound is seen both in the epithelium as well as connective tissue. It is together. And intramucosal is seen only within the connective tissue, the nevus cells, I mean. So that's the other classification. There are several other nevus also, blue nevus, Pitt's nevus, halo nevus. I don't want you to get confused. I just want you to know these two classifications. One is congenital, that is at birth. Second is acquired, which comes later. And histopathologically, you can classify it into intramucosal, junctional, and compound. Junctional is at the junction of epithelium and connective tissue. Compound is when it is present both in epithelium and connective tissue, and intramucosal is just within connective tissue. I think it's very easy. Okay, can we continue? Okay. So this intramucosal nevus is the presentation of it is like a pigmented lesion which is present on the palate, with the other one which we saw was on gingiva. This is on the palate. And 85% of the oral nevi are found in patients who are younger than 40 years of age. And it is seen in all races, all ethnicities, but it is more frequently seen in whites, probably because it's noticed more frequently in them because of the contrast in the skin color. It is asymptomatic, absolutely no symptom. And it can be mistaken for many, many things like melanotic macules, amalgam tattoos. You can see it here. In fact, this you can easily get confused as an amalgam tattoo. What is this? It's a restorative material, amalgam. It's no longer used because of its mercury toxicity, but it used to be used extensively for many, many, many years. And even now there are some people who prefer using amalgam because it's less expensive compared to your composite restoration, which is a tooth colored restoration. And because of a lot of advances in composite, the material is expensive, so the filling is also expensive compared to amalgam. So amalgam is a cheaper alternative, so a lot of people still use it. So amalgam tattoo is when amalgam seeps into the oral tissue underneath or surrounding the restoration, then it can cause like a discoloration in that area. So that's called as amalgam tattoo. Smoker's melanosis or any pigmented lesion, it can be confused with. So histopathologically, whatever we discussed in the clinical classification, same thing we see in histology as well. So what are these? These are your melanocytes. Okay, so these are the nevus cells just at the junction of your epithelium and connective tissue. Here you will see the nevus cells, see here in the epithelium as well as in the connective tissue, these clumps of nevus cells which you see in the connective tissue. That's the compound. So that is present, mucosal meaning connective tissue, only in the connective tissue. So this is just a higher power micrograph of the nevus cells and how they look. So you can very clearly distinguish it from the surrounding cell because of the color of them. It can take up quite a dark color. So what's the management? The reason why we do excision of this pigmented lesion is because there is a chance that it can be malignant melanoma, which we're going to study in the next lecture. They have a very similar appearance, and we don't want to take a chance. And malignant melanoma is quite, it has a very poor prognosis. So we don't want to take a risk. So whenever we see that there is a pigmented lesion which is quite big, or if the patient says that there is any kind of change in color or texture or size or something like that, then you have to excise it and send it for histopathological examination, like I said, to rule out the malignant melanoma. So this is the same in case of skin also, even for you or your friends or family or whoever. You know, there are some people who have like a lot of moles on their face or on their like chest and body. So they have to notice if there is any change in the size, shape, color, and texture. So this is the main indication that it is becoming malignant. Okay, it could have been benign when it starts, like benign nevus, but if there is any change in these four things, that is size, shape, color, texture, and even symmetry, then it is an indication that it's undergoing malignant change. Okay, so what are the differential diagnoses of this? Any white lesion you have to differentiate when it comes to your benign lesions like leukoedema, frictional keratosis, cheek biting, Fordyce's granule, stomatitis nicotina, thrush, and there are many other white lesions. They all have to be differentiated from each other histopathologically and from your pre-malignant lesion or condition. So there is one particular white lesion which people might mistake it with the leukoplakia, that is your pre-malignant lesion. So let's see what that is. That's called as leukoedema. This is normally seen in buccal mucosa and it appears as a variation of the normal, and it is present in about 90% of blacks, racially I mean. And what happens to the buccal mucosa is it retains its normal softness and flexibility, but it exhibits a grayish white, slightly folded opalescent appearance, like a velvet-like veil it is described as. Another appearance it can show is mother of pearl appearance, wherein the lesion is quite diffuse and it shows a filmy mother of pearl appearance. You know what's mother of pearl, right? Like it's used as a dial in a lot of your watches if you want to see what mother of pearl appearance is. And it will have delicate overlapping curtains like mucosal folds. So this is how it appears clinically. Okay, so this can resemble leukoplakia and people might get confused, but this is a benign epithelial lesion. And how can you differentiate between leukoplakia and this is that it is bilateral and it's more grayish kind of a thickening which you see. And the most interesting part is this is a lesion. When the mucosa is stretched, it disappears. It looks normal. And again, when you leave the mucosa, it again goes back to this shape. That is called as leukoedema. So it is eliminated by the stretching and scraping of mucosa. And that's how you differentiate leukoedema from leukoplakia. And there is a desquamation which can leave the surface eroded and reddish. That is also a clinical scenario possible, but in most cases it appears as this translucent grayish thickening or mother of pearl appearance, which on stretching disappears. Okay, that's the most unique feature of leukoedema. So histologically you will see there is a thickening of the epithelium with the intracellular edema. There is a lot of edema on the higher power micrograph. If you see, there's a lot of edema within the epithelial cells. Treatment is not necessary for this at all. It can stay. You just have to notice or follow up. So just to recollect, we studied three benign lesions. That is, we started with the squamous papilloma, then keratoacanthoma, and the last one was the nevi, which is very important because that has to be differentiated with the malignant melanoma. So squamous papilloma looks like a cauliflower-like projection. It's an exophytic growth, and histopathologically it has same finger-like projection with a core of connective tissue and keratin on the top, which gives it the white color. Whereas keratoacanthoma looks like a crater-like depression. It's an endophytic growth. And even histopathologically, you will see a crater filled with keratin, and the border between the normal and the abnormal is quite stark, and there are broad ridges which shows pseudocarcinomatous growth. Pseudo means false, okay? False carcinomatous impression it gives. And the last one was the nevi. Based on how the nevus is situated, it's classified as junctional compound and intramucosal.